Wellington is annoying. I never thought I'd say this, but I actually find Old Bag less annoying than him. At least her rambling comes from the fact that she's an old lady with no filter. Wellington's comes from the fact that he has to be as pedantic as possible about everything. It's like meeting a YouTube commenter in real life. His only redeeming factor is that he actually had a clever plan in giving Phoenix amnesia, but everything else that happened to him was a result of him being too paranoid for his own good. And because of him, Maggie lost her boyfriend. There's just really nothing that's likable about this guy. So, I guess I'm just gonna go to his voice. A commenter mentioned last time that they can see him being voiced by the guy who voiced Pleakley in Lilo and Stitch, and yeah, I agree. I think it's because I heard him with that voice in A Phoenix Wrong somewhere, but yeah. Only problem is, Pleakley actually has two voices. In all four movies and Lilo and Stitch the series, he was voiced by Kevin MacDonald. But in the anime series Stitch, he was voiced by Ted Biaselli. Well, the only one I'm familiar with is Kevin MacDonald, so I guess he's the one I'd go with. Dr. Gray is one of those guys that you think is going to be a villain when you first meet him, but this is one of the few cases where he actually isn't. Well, maybe. His villainy is only implied, as Mimi, believes that his control freak tendencies were what drove her to fall asleep at the wheel and cause Innie's death. We're never given a clear answer as to if that's true or not. I guess it doesn't help that the sprite we see of him most often has him flipping us off when he adjusts his glasses. Yeah, anime characters don't seem to realize that most people don't adjust their glasses with that finger. Some people like to compare him to House, but for his voice, he should sound a bit gruff, but not too deep given his personality. I'd say that makes Crispin Freeman a perfect match. Mimi is actually a pretty good villain, and a sympathetic one at that. First off, no one would suspect her with that valley girl demeanor she affects, and she has a good motive. She lost everything. Her job, her sister, and after the car crash, even her identity. To the point that by the time the case is over, it's pretty understandable why she did what she did. Hopefully she can finally find rest one of these days. When it comes to her voice, though, well, I couldn't think of a good voice actress for her at first until I started looking at live-action actresses, and another fiery redhead jumped out at me. Allison Hannigan. I've seen her play both sides of this character, the ignorant teenager and the woman overcome with the desire for vengeance. And I think you can see why I chose her for this role. Maximilian Galactica, real name Billy Bob Johns, is a great magician. The problem is, he knows it. Admittedly, he has an ego the size of a small planet, but Max isn't all bad. The way he sees it, after tasting worldwide fame at the Magician's Grand Prix, he wants everyone he works with to experience that feeling. Problem is, most of the others don't have the same ambitions he does, and he can't understand why. As much of an ass as Max can be, however, there's no denying that he has talent. And in the end, he's actually kind of the driving force behind the other performers getting the circus back together. Also, we learn that he's a country boy who took the job as a magician to pay off the debts on his family's farm. So at least he's a kind-hearted jerk. And really, there's only one actor I know who has the charisma to pull that off enough to carry this character. Neil Patrick Harris. Come on, you know he could do it. Despite the joke I made in the review, Regina is more of a parody Sue than an actual Mary Sue. It's hinted a few times that even though Regina lives a fairy tale life that most kids used to dream of, you know, running away and joining the circus, that used to be a thing. Anyway, because of that, she also has trouble facing reality. Her father raised her like a princess, and thus, she kind of acts like one. She can't comprehend the full impact of death, or that Trilo is, you know, a puppet. In fact, the other characters say that she needs to see the trial because she needs to learn to deal with what happened. But her idealism isn't all bad. One day the two brothers might be reunited. We can only hope. Regina's voice, damn, that's a tough one. I can see how she would get on some people's nerves, but at the same time, she still has a cuteness about her. I've got it! Monica Rial! Unfortunately, Benjamin, like Grossberg, is one of those characters that's just kind of there. Like I said, he's one of those weird ventriloquist characters that mostly talks through his puppet, who appears to have more personality than he does. But sadly, that's not much of a personality. When it comes to personality, Ben is pretty much a non-entity. So as such, I don't think it matters much who voices him. Mo is another character whose premise is very cliched, the sad clown. But for how much of a cliché this is, I think it kind of works here. I think the main reason is that Mo's actually self-aware. He knows he's not that funny, and as a result, it's often him who laughs the hardest at one of his jokes. Even though he tries so hard to entertain people, they just don't find him all that funny. And that's honestly something I can relate to. Which is why, in the end, he decides to hang up his clown shoes and become the new ringmaster. And I can honestly see him doing that. He's a good cook, and Regina sees him as an uncle, so we know he's good at taking care of the other performers. And when it comes to his voice, I think I'll go with Jim Cummings. Not only is he a generally great voice actor, but he reminds me of a few other characters he's played. I think it works. Turnabout Big Top was pretty much a soap opera, wasn't it? We have so many love triangles, stories of hidden murder plots and dead siblings, and in the end, all of it resulted in a tragic and accidental death. And nowhere is that more evident than in Acro's story. As a result of a prank gone wrong, Acro's brother Bat was basically killed while trying to impress Regina, and Acro's legs were injured to the point where he could no longer perform. Acro felt as though Regina could never fully understand what she had done to his brother, and that eventually drove him to seek revenge. But instead of killing her, he killed Russell Berry, the man who had been more of a father to him than his real father. Now, you can say what you will about how contrived or unlikely the events in Turnabout Big Top were, but I have to admit, I still get teary-eyed at several points during it. Acro's story is very sympathetic, and I genuinely felt for him, and I hope that someday he'll be reunited with his brother, even if, in his case, it'll be from the opposite side of a glass wall. His voice, well, I honestly have to go with Vic Mignogna.
Vic?
Gah?
Min?
Rue?
Nya?
Gah?
Na?
Mesh?
On this one. I've seen quite a few of his performances, and I think he's capable of capturing the tragic side of him as well as the human side. If any slash Mimi's obfuscating stupidity was impressive, Matt has it down to an art. Who would have thought that beneath that oblivious exterior and the cool racing jacket was an evil, pretty nihilistic man that has the ability to pull out glasses of... Actually, I have no idea what that is. I guess it's because I don't drink, but what kind of alcoholic beverage is dark brown? Schnapps? I'd say it was beer, but it's flat. Doesn't beer usually have foam on top? I did find this pretty hilarious post on a forum that said, "Only real men carry chocolate milk in wine glasses, though." Anyway, I'm getting off topic. Matt is a great villain, and like Von Karma, it's mostly for just how incredibly evil he is. But where Von Karma's fall came from one piece of evidence he couldn't get rid of, Matt's came about because he was too paranoid and vengeful. If he had just hired an assassin like everybody else, this wouldn't have happened. Man, you suck at this. Still, after all he does in this case, it's extremely satisfying to see him get his comeuppance. For his voice, I'm going with Brad Swale. Because we all know he's good at playing the maniac that you least suspect. And again, that's all of the one-shot characters. Yeah, I know. I think this game had even less of them than the last one. And since this is the second retrospective video, I'm going to go over the rules for recurring characters. I'll still talk about their growth and development over the course of the game, but I won't give their voice suggestions because, well, I've already done it. With that said, let's go on to the recurring characters. In case you didn't notice, I really wasn't a fan of the whole Edgeworth is dead thing this game. Now granted, Phoenix did have his reasons. He thought that Edgeworth had given up on his development in the first game that made him more likable, and forgotten that he was going to use his prosecuting abilities to pursue the truth instead of just a guilty verdict. So for all intents and purposes, he was dead to him.
So what I told you was true, from a certain point of view.
But still, that felt a bit forced to me, and more than a little mean-spirited toward a guy Phoenix had previously called a friend. That being said, I really do admire Phoenix's development in Justice for All. Not once, but twice, Maya was put in danger, and Phoenix was willing to risk everything to save her. By this point, Phoenix, is there really any point in denying that you love her? Well, besides the fact that her sister could pop up inside her at any time. Yeah, I can see how that would make a relationship awkward. But by the last case, Mia asked Phoenix an important question. What would Phoenix have said if Francisca hadn't burst in with the evidence? It's a surprisingly thought-provoking question, and it really makes you wonder what you would have done if you were in the same situation he was. Then again, you are making the choices for him. You know what I mean. I really like Maggie as a character. It's kind of impossible not to. She has this desire to help other people, which is why she became a police officer, but she's also cursed with incredibly bad luck. To the point where some people actually refer to her as the Goddess of Misfortune. Damn, that's pretty harsh. It's hard not to feel for Maggie after losing Dustin, even if we didn't know Dustin beforehand. But she's cute, she's charming, she's got a good heart, and it's really impossible not to like her in the end. During the credits, she says she's going to be hanging up her policeman's uniform to become a waitress? Okay, but I'm pretty sure police work pays better. Anyway, I hope that works out well for her. For her voice, well, you know what? She reminds me so much of Yui from Lucky Star. Let's give her Yui's English voice actress, Julianne Taylor. I don't care about pain, and frankly, neither should you. Next. Like I mentioned earlier, some people seem to think that Gumshoe was a lot worse in this game than he was in the first Ace Attorney. Frankly, after watching through Justice for All again, my response is, what the hell game were you playing? Sure, he was fired, and before that he was demoted to Francisca's whipping boy, but frankly, everyone gets that treatment from her. And how quickly they forget that even after getting fired, Gumshoe was still putting himself out there to help Phoenix. And even if they weren't technically on the same side, he still jumped at the chance to help him out when he learned that Maya was kidnapped. You know, you're entitled to your opinion, but to me, Gumshoe remains who he was in the first game. An underrated character and an unlikely hero. You know how I said Maya was a strong character? Well, this game is where that starts to become clearer. Now, admittedly, her situation doesn't look that good. In Case 2, she was accused of murder, and in Case 4, she was kidnapped. But we're not entering Princess Peach territory. This is actually the only time Maya gets kidnapped in the series, believe it or not. And remember, even while she was kidnapped by a professional assassin, she was using Mia's help to give clues to everyone, and leaving clues behind personally in case Phoenix arrived at the scene. All of this while under the watchful eye of a professional killer. This girl does not fuck around, and I love her for it. It's easy to get annoyed with Pearl on occasion, especially with her trying to play matchmaker to Phoenix and Maya. Yes, I know I want them to get together, Pearl, but not like this.
Not like this.
But at the same time, it's also kind of hard not to like her. Pearl's lived a very sheltered life thanks to her mother, who wanted her to focus only on her spirit channeling. And as a result, she knows very little about the outside world. She soon proves to be a valuable ally, however, charging up the Magatama for Phoenix to use, as well as channeling Mia when he needs her help. But during all that, it's easy to forget that Pearl is still a kid. A kid that was forced to grow up in a hurry. But for all that, I think she holds up really well. For her voice, I choose Hendon Walsh. Do I even need to explain why? Morgan is creepy, but as the case progresses, you kind of start to see where she's coming from. She feels rejected and jealous that her family, no matter how strong their spiritual power would become, could never lead the Karain school. On top of that, her powers, in a cruel twist of fate, were almost non-existent. However, a glimmer of hope was found in her daughter, Pearl, who possessed spiritual power that rivaled even the Master's. It was for this reason that Morgan helped Mimi go through with her murder plot to set up Pearl as the master of the Karain school by getting Maya out of the way. In the end, everything she did was for her daughter. Well, okay, part of it was because of her own jealousy for her sister's power.
I'm living out my childhood ambitions through you.
She's not wholly sympathetic, but she does make a good villain. As for her voice, well, call me predictable, but I got a serious Ursula vibe from her. She can appear genteel and likable, but she also has one hell of a temper. And Pat Carroll, Ursula's voice actress, has said that Ursula was one of her favorite roles. So I think it wouldn't be too far to suggest that she voiced Morgan as well. Lada hasn't really changed much since the last game. Well, granted, she's less in your way than in the last game, and she may have started out the game as a paranormal photographer only to become a tabloid photographer later on, but she's pretty much the same personality-wise. It's pretty clear that actually being on the scene of a murder leaves her shell-shocked, however, which is probably why she changed careers. Well, at least she's not giving false testimony this time. It's easy to just dismiss Franziska at first, and the fact that she whips everyone who opposes her doesn't really do a good job of making her likable. But there are times when she just whips people because they're wasting her time or just being morons. And most of the time, they actually are. I kind of admire her take-no-crap attitude, even if she considers Phoenix an enemy. She does evil things, but it's all in the name of living up to her father's name, in search of perfection. Only trouble is, he got that image by rigging every trial he was on. Believe it or not, though, as weird as it is, I actually kind of like Franziska. She's definitely more likable than her dad ever was, anyway. And I know that's not saying a lot, but hopefully by the end of the series, you'll start to see why. When it comes to her voice, you know, I always pictured her with the voice of Linka from Captain Planet. Yeah, I know Linka was from the Soviet Union and that makes no sense, but maybe it's the way she says Mr. Phoenix Wright all the time. For some reason, the two kind of blend together in my head. So, who played Linka anyway? Kath Soucie? Well, how about that? This guy is one creepy motherfucker, and coming from me, that says something. It's clear from the beginning that he's not the real director, just some guy who likes to pretend to be in order to look at young girls. That's pretty much it, really. And sadly, we will be seeing him again later on. Joy. Well, you know what? Just for that, let's give him Hoppasized voice, Paul Dobson. I'd call that a fitting punishment. Will's still the same lovable yet scary-looking kids action star we met in the last game, and it's good to see him again. And apparently the Pink Princess did pretty well and even got to run its full course. But now Will's on an exercise program for kids, while wearing a bunny outfit. Will, this can't be good for your dignity. Haven't you heard of plastic surgery? I mean, I hear the Hottie Clinic has a special. Actually, forget I said anything. Remember how I said that Old Bag had most of her character development in the first game and became a joke character later on? Well, I was wrong. In Justice for All, she gets character development, but it's pretty much recycled from Turnabout Samurai. Seriously. Instead of being a fan of Hammer, she's now a fan of Juan Corrida. Instead of working security at Global Studios, she's now working security for the Gatewater Hotel. In a weird alien outfit. Other than that, it's pretty much the exact same story with her, only, well, it's a lot less poignant the second time. Despite him kidnapping Maya, I have to say Shelley DeKiller is pretty fascinating as a character to me. The idea of him being from a hidden clan of assassins, but also having a sense of humor and trust with his clients, is an interesting one. But the unfortunate thing is, we really don't get a lot of time with him. He's basically relegated to plot device status in terms of story, and that's a shame. As far as his voice goes, hard to say, really. I mean, he's got to have a sophisticated sort of voice, perhaps with a hint of playfulness, but also possess the ability to sound intimidating. Actually, what about Pierce Brosnan? Yeah, I think that could work. But I just wish he could get a bit more time in the spotlight. Wait, he appears again in Ace Attorney Investigations 2? I know people are probably sick of the whole woman who seems tough on the outside but just needs someone to expose the delicate flower she really is on the inside cliché, but to be fair, I think it works in Adrian's case. If you factor in her personality and her mentor's death, her actions make a lot of sense. But she's still likable and even manages to become a stronger character later on, especially in the next game. And from what I've heard, a lot of people like to say she's a lesbian, but I never got that vibe. She's just an emotionally unstable woman who needed someone to help her keep going. But trust me when I say that eventually she overcomes that hurdle and becomes a better person for it. So good for her. So let's see. For her voice. You know, I can honestly see Tara Platt voicing her. You know, Tamari's voice actress. She's kind of like a reverse Adrian. At first she's cool and tough, but later on she starts to demonstrate that she actually has a softer side. And the voice matches up with the character design pretty well, in my opinion. I said before that if it's not Maya, Edgeworth goes through the most character development in the series, and I think that's true here too. After the last game ended, Edgeworth was unsure of what he was doing as a prosecutor, deciding to go off on a journey to find that answer. When he returned, Phoenix got the feeling that he could actually trust Edgeworth, and that's because he figured it out. See, as Edgeworth says, it's not about beating your enemy in court, it's about pursuing the truth. And if the only way to do that is for the prosecution and the defense to bounce ideas off each other in battle-like court scenarios, then that's what they'll have to do. But even if they're not on the same side, it's clear that Edgeworth has grown more friendly toward Phoenix since the last game. And his growth into a heroic character will only continue as the series goes on. And that's all for my thoughts on the characters. So, what did I think of Justice for All as a whole? Well, I've heard some people say that this is the weakest game in the series, and I can kinda see why. The first case is full of cliches, the second one has Maya get accused of murder, again. The third case seems contrived almost to the point of being a soap opera, and the last case has Maya get kidnapped. But does that mean I don't like Justice for All? Hell no! Cases 2, 3, and 4 are brilliant. Case 2 was a good continuation of Maya's journey into becoming a stronger medium, and even as contrived as some people might say Turnabout Big Top was, I still liked the characters and the story, and it was still a very tragic tale that got me to tear up more than any other case in this series, even as silly as the idea could be. And Case 4, holy shit, that was intense! In the end, it really came down to the wire and had me on the edge of my seat from beginning to end. It's fun, it's thought-provoking, it's got great characters, and hence the already good gameplay. Yeah, maybe Justice for All is the weakest of the series, but in my opinion, the weakest out of this series is still a great game that's definitely worth your time. And that's it. We're finally done with Justice for All. It only took me 6 months. Wait. We're done with Justice for All. Oh my god, that means next time is... Well, that's just great. Now I can't think of a good song to go out on. Francisca, can you help me out here?
Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip,
we don't want to go to war today. But the Lord of the Lashes has nay, nay, nay. We're going to march all day, all day, all day.
Where there's a whip, there's a way. 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 Left, right, left. Where there's a whip, there's a way. Left, right. A crack on the back says we're gonna fight. We're gonna march all day and night and more. For we are the slaves of the dark lords. Left, right, left, right, left, right. Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip,
we don't wanna go to war today. But the Lord of the Lashes says, nay, nay, nay. We're gonna march all day, all day, all day.
Where there's a whip, there's a way. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left.